Okay, so our magical mystery tour continues with the town of Montalcino, which is another one of our favorite spots that we've been visiting over the 20 years living in Florence. Montalcino is in the province of Siena. It's about 25 miles and 42 kilometers from Siena and about 110 kilometers or 70 miles from Florence. It's built a big hilltop town, and it's got spectacular views of the Val d'Orcia area. A little history in background. The monks of the Abbey of Sant'Antimo are credited with building the first church around 800. And then probably in the 1300s, the walls began to be built. And the Fortezza, which we're looking at, that's a photo above my painting, that was built in around 1361. Now the town itself, Montalcino, it gets its name from a variety of oak trees that once covered the entire train, but as you'll see in my photo, on my painting on the bottom, they're still there. And talk a little bit about the fortress. It was, as I mentioned, built around 1361. And again, it was used in the battles between, there was probably 2 centuries of battles all throughout Tuscany between the Guelphs and the Ghibellines. And if I remember correctly, the Guelphs were on the side of the papacy and the Ghibellines were on the side of the Roman Empire. And they fought for a couple hundred years. And finally, as most of the other towns in the area, in the 1500s, Montalcino became part of the Medici Empire. So the interesting thing about this fort right now, the Fortezza, is it's basically the center of all the activities in the town. Now, inside the fort, twice a year, they have these crazy old archery contests where the locals of Montalcino, which is divided into 4 quarters or what they call contrades, they get together and they have these archery contests, and they all get dressed up in medieval clothes, and they have the appointed lords and ladies. And we've actually been to one of them, and it's quite a spectacular. And the most fun is inside the fortress. It is a famous enoteca where you can sample many, many types of the Brunellos that the town of Montalcino is mostly famous. And I think most of us know about Montalcino because of the Brunello. And according to history, it had been the Brunello grape was similar to the Sangiovese grape. In fact, is the Sangiovese grape. But it was in the late 1800s that a guy named Ferruccio Bondi Santi, who was a veteran soldier who had fought along the side of Garibaldi in the revolution, he was the first person that released the version of what is known as Brunello di Montalcino. And it's 100% Sangiovese. Currently, they were probably the first winery until after World War II, there's many vineyards and wineries that have sprung up to the point where now there's probably about 200 producing this delicious wine. But back to my painting, this painting is actually right across the street from the Fortezza. And it's, again, it's a view of the Val d'Orcia. And it's just absolutely spectacular. And the one thing that I noticed, it was one of the first landscapes I've ever painted. I painted this in 2001. And the thing we noticed, and as you can see, there's still quite a few oak trees, which is highly unusual for Tuscany, because most of the land is covered with cypress and olive tree. But this is a totally different view, absolutely spectacular, and very much like my native New England. It almost looks like a scene from Vermont or New Hampshire, where I actually had a home in New Hampshire one time. But anyway, the very first painting from Montalcino, I went on to do several more in the surrounding areas and in the village itself, and we'll go on to those now. Now, these two paintings are from a subsequent trip that we took to Montalcino, and this time we went in the springtime. We actually stayed for a couple of days, and I was able to bring my little easel, and we went outside the walls, and I set up in a couple of different places and started paintings, which I then completed back at my studio in Florence. Both of these paintings are 24 inches by 32 inches. And the top one, I would say, is a little more schizophrenic, because if you look to the right, on the right side, it's pretty traditional with the greens and the fields and the green and the light siennas of the mountains in the background. And then we have the old house. I think we call this the house in the olive field painting, La Casa il Campo di Uluvi. And then on the left side, we got all these wild and crazy colors, which was a challenge. But again, I think as a whole, it really comes together. And I've got these very, very strong purples and golds in the olive trees, and then the light blues. And then it's almost like a magenta purplish road, which is, again, different than the Tuscan colors. On you can see the little road to the right of this painting, which is next to the gold and the green bushes. In fact, that road is the road in the bottom painting from a different angle. But anyway, I really like the way this thing came out. It doesn't clash, in my opinion. I think it works, and I think it's balanced primarily because of the softness of the hills and the sky. Again, this was in the springtime, but you still have that very, very light viola, almost whitish viola, in the hills in the background, and then the very light greens. So what contrasts with that is the foreground, where you've got these very bright blue trees and purple trees. But once again, taken as a whole, I think this particular composition, very strong, and it works. Now, the bottom painting, a little more traditional, but I blend in the old Tuscan road, you know, that deep earth-colored tone, and balance it against these trees that, again, are a lot of the blues and the purple, but it's not quite as diversified as the painting on the top. It really molds very well, because it grooves right in with the hills and that pinkish brown field in the back, and then again the clouds, and then instead of the purple hills, we have the sort of blue. So it's a lot of combinations here of the blues and violets, and this beautiful road that just opens up to the viewer as you're standing there. As I mentioned, both of these are 24 by 32 inches. The top painting is owned by Mike and Marion Peters of Orlando, Florida. The bottom painting by Colleen Oldfield from Toronto, Canada, and Sarasota. The comment on the left is from the art historian Sister Wendy Beckett, who, as I've mentioned before, I had a long time correspondence with. And sometimes I would send her books from the art shows, and other times photos from my trips. And this particular time, I had sent her a bunch of photos of the landscapes around Montalcino. And I think this is a very warm and thoughtful quote. I'll go along with you. It's, the new work is wonderful, so rich, full, glowing, and alive. I especially like the pure landscapes, those vibrant trees and distant hills. So lovely, you work the softly glowing colors so convincingly. And that's basically what I was saying earlier. I think the contrast with the trees and then the distant hills, it really works. And, or she says it even better, the softly glowing colors are very convincing. Now, one of the days that I was working on the two previous paintings, I was walking back up the hill towards the village, and I was going to meet Susan, and she was coming down, and I'm looking at the scene that you see with the two women right now, but Susan captured it. I was carrying an easel and a canvas, and she just took this photo. And when we got back to the studio in Florence, I just loved this image. It was a Sunday, and it's just the beautiful pace of life that the people in the country live. I mean, it is so much different than walking around the streets of Florence, which, again, we love Florence and we love the hustle bustle. But when you get out to the villages like Montalcino, and it's just so peaceful, and it's almost like you want to reach out and give these women a hand and help them, you know, come up the hill, maybe move a little faster. But they're in their own little world. There's just this quiet serenity about this, and it's one of the paintings that we just absolutely love from Montalcino. Now, this painting Cafe Fisciateria Italiana brings back wonderful memories to me and Susan from our many trips to Montalcino. But this particular trip in October of 2009 was to go to the La Sagra del Tordo. And I'll talk about the painting in detail in a few minutes, but just a little history of this weekend. The La Sagra del Tordo is basically the festival of the thrush, and it sort of celebrates the migration of the birds from the north. It's similar to the opening of the hunting season going back to the Middle Ages. And what happens in Montalcino, like most Italian villages, it's divided into four quarters. It's the Borghetto, Pianello, the Ruga, and the Traviglio. And every October, they get dressed up in traditional medieval age dressing, and they have a procession of about 150 locals in these historic costumes, and they have these parades with drums and trumpets, and it's really a wonderful thing to see. It starts at the center of the town, in the main square, the Piazza della Principessa Margherita, or the Piazza del Priore. And it's the center of the town. Then they eventually march up to the Fortezza, where they get involved in these pretty serious archery contests. But again, it's quite a festival, and it's a fun weekend. And fortunately for us, we had, and unfortunately for our friends, but we have good friends and collectors, Brenda Patton and Steve Hutchinson. They had a reservation. They were going to be going to this also at the Il Grillo Hotel, which is one of the old coach houses that's been renovated back in the 1990s by the Marchetti family. And it's just one of the nicest old traditional hotels in Montalcino. Unfortunately, Steve and Brenda had to cancel, so we took their reservation and we spent the weekend. And now a little bit about this painting. As you can tell, the last weekend in October in Montalcino, because it's up on a high up in a hill, it was a little cold, and it rained off and on. Now, this cafe, Susan and I had always stopped on over the years when we go there, but usually just sitting outside. But on this particular day, it was pretty chilly, and we went inside. And it's just a fantastically designed place. It's the old 19th century decor, and it has all this brass and mirrors and ornate lights, and you could sit there all day. In fact, we were doing that. And then I didn't have my easel. I left at one point and crossed the street. There's a loggia. We're looking at the cafe from the loggia, and to our left is a medieval tower with a big clock. But when I took these photos, I brought back to my studio, and I spent a lot of time getting, I think, the colors from the inside. If you start with the inside and you see those golden lights from the old 19th century light, but they're reflecting on, there are people. If you look closely, you can see a lot of people inside both of the windows. And again, you have the traditional or the typical Italian outside having their cigarettes, even though it's cold and rainy, because around 2000 they did pass the no smoking law. But the colors in this painting, I think, really work. If you start with the gold and brown background, and then the blues with the lettering, and it was kind of fun to kind of do the lettering in the old style. And it took me a little while. I made a few mistakes, but it came out, in my opinion, with the feeling that I wanted. And I contrast that with the very dark purple awning in the spelling. Antica Cantina means old cellar, because this is where, again, they were in the 1800s. This is where they were making the Brunello, which again is their most famous wine. Then again, back to the painting. With the blues of the background, which contrast, I think, perfectly with the lights from the inside. And then those simple little white chairs where actually nobody is sitting except for one couple underneath the awning. And I made the plants sort of the bluish They're generally green that time of year, but I wanted to sort of blend them in with the building itself. And once again, if you look at the reflections on the sidewalk, you'll see that they there's some sparkles of yellow and orange right at the bottom of the painting, which are reflecting the lights from inside the cafe itself. Again, this was just a wonderful weekend. This reminds us so much of how typically ancient that Montalcino can be when they celebrate these kinds of festivals and have these beautiful places that you can enjoy the time at. Now, I'm going to show a video of the parade on the next screen, and it'll give you a feeling of what we had seen during that weekend. Before we go on to the next screen, I just want to add that this painting is in the private collection of Steve Hutchinson and Brenda Patton. Our good friends unfortunately couldn't make the trip that weekend, and they have it at their home in Sarasota, Florida. Now, I would say that's a fun way to spend an afternoon. What a great tradition. And it's just amazing that the Italians, and in this particular case, the people of the village of Montalcino, celebrate their traditions of hundreds of years. As I mentioned, this festival is held at the last weekend in October, right before All Saints Day, and it's going on for hundreds of years. So my hat's off to the people of Montalcino. Now let's get back to talking about some paintings. Now the title of this painting is Tuscan Harmony. It's 36 by 48 inches. In the title, to me, this painting, it's almost mysterious to me. It's very different from most of the landscapes that I've done from Tuscany. This one is from the outskirts of Montalcino. But again, it's very, very different. I'm not sure why I just painted the three trees in the middle, because from some backup photos and sketches that I used for this painting, there are several trees in the area, and it was also in the autumn. So the foreground painting, the oranges and the yellow, they're fairly accurate. But then we go into the field. At the time, the field, it wasn't, in reality, it wasn't that really nice Siena color that I love. It was sort of an off brown, which in that time of year, I didn't particularly like the color. So I just sort of made up this magenta, and it goes in, you know, backs off into the nice grass of the little field. But the field is almost like an island. And again, a lot of this painting is a little mysterious to me, because I just was going along and I decided to do the background olive trees behind the three trees in just one little light blue color, which normally I make several different colors. I'll throw in some purples and some silver, but and the background there, the big hill, pretty much matches the colors of the three trees. And then again at the top we have the soft hues of the hills on way off in the back. However, I really like the way this composition works, and if you've seen particularly some of the earlier landscapes that I've done from Montalcino, this is really different, but it is harmonious, and I just came up with that title, Tuscan Harmony, and I think it works. And it's now in the collection of Mickey and Brooke Callanan, Darien, Connecticut, and Sarasota, Florida. Now, this is the final painting that I'm going to talk about in this initial group of paintings from Montalcino, although we have several more series to discuss in detail paintings from vineyards in the Montalcino area, such as Caselli di Bibbiano, the Caparzo Vineyard, and also Poggio Antico. And they'll be coming in the next few series.